Hey, this is Chris Plush from CG Masters, and in this tutorial, I'm going to show you how to quickly and easily make this dust in the wind type special effect. Now, if you want to follow along, this is a step-by-step tutorial, and you can find the start file for it in the description underneath the video. But it's also one of those tutorials you can just watch straight through without actually following along, and you'll get a good idea of how things are done. Now, the first thing I'm going to do is go over to the render buttons and make sure I set the frame rate to 60 frames a second. I want to animate this at a higher frame rate because when I see those dust particles flying off the column, I want them to have that ultra smooth flow that you get from a higher frame rate. And now what we're going to do is start things off by subtracting pieces of the column from top to bottom. So let me press numpad 1 for front view and numpad 5 for orthographic view. Now our cursor should be centered at the bottom center of the column. If it's not, I'll press Shift and S and choose cursor to center, and I'll center it in the world. And now let's press Shift and A and add a mesh cube. Let me press Tab to go into edit mode. And with all the vertices selected, I'll press G and then Z and hold Control and move that up one Blender unit. And now let's press the period key to scale away from the 3D cursor. And now I'll press S to scale it up so that it's a little bit bigger than the column. And I'll left click to keep it there. And now I'll press S and then Z and scale it all the way up until it's a little bit taller than the column and left click there. Now what we're going to do is animate this box from top to bottom, and we're going to use a Boolean modifier to subtract from the column as this box is moving down and over it. But we don't actually want to render this box, so let's take care of that right now. I'm going to go to my outliner window, which I have tucked away up there, and the cube is selected, so I'm going to click on the camera icon there to turn off render visibility. So this won't actually render in the final product, but we can still use it for the Boolean modifier. So let me press Tab to get out of edit mode now, and let's press Shift and D to duplicate this, and then right click to keep it in place. Then press Tab to go into edit mode, press A to deselect, then press B and left click and drag over those vertices. Now press G and then Z, and we'll bring it all the way down here just to make a small sliver like that. And I'll explain what this is for in a minute. Let's press Tab to get out of edit mode. And now what we're going to do is parent this to the bigger box. So hold Shift, right click on the bigger box, then press Control and P and parent to object. And just so we don't get confused later on, let's name these things. I'm going to press the N key for the right side toolbar, and let's select the bigger cube here, and we'll rename this to big box. And select that small sliver down there, and we'll rename this to sliver. Now let's select big box and we can start animating this. So let me press G and then Z, and I'll move that all the way up until it's just above the column like that. And since we parented the sliver with it, it's coming along for the ride. So now we're going to start animating. I don't want it to start animating at frame 0. I want there to be a couple of seconds of nothing, and then it comes down on the column. So let's move ahead to frame 50. And then with that big box selected, I'll press the I key to insert a keyframe, and I'll insert the location. Now let's move ahead to frame 450. That'll be the last frame of the visible column, or maybe a couple frames after. Now let's press G and then Z. Move that column all the way down to right there. Let's make sure the sliver is beneath the column, which it is. And let's make sure it encompasses the whole thing, which it does. So with that there, let's press the I key again and insert a location keyframe there. So let me go back to frame 0, and I'll press Alt and A to play the animation. And we'll see what it looks like. So this will be subtracting from the column as it goes all the way down, and then right about there the entire column is completely gone. Cool. It looks like we'll only need about 600 frames for this animation, so let me type that into the end frame down there. Now if we go into shaded view by pressing Z, you can see that these are solid shaded, and that's kind of obstructive since we don't actually need to see them. So what I'm going to do is go over to the object buttons here. And where's it at? Right here, the maximum draw type option. Let's change that to wire. And then let's select the sliver object and we'll do the same thing. We'll change that to wire as well. Now let's select the column object and let's go over to the modifier buttons. Actually, let's press the N key over the 3D view, get rid of that toolbar. And over in the modifiers, click add modifier and add a Boolean modifier. Let's change the operation to difference, and in the object field, choose big box. Now let's press Alt and A over the 3D view and let's see how that looks. And there we go, we're off to a good start. So it'll subtract that all the way down until it's completely gone, And now we just need something at the top of that column as it goes down in order to use to create a particle system. So let's press Shift and D to duplicate the column and then right click to keep it in place. Let's change the operation over here to intersect, and let's change the target object to sliver. Now you can see that column has actually disappeared. That column will only be visible in the space where our sliver object is. So if I press Alt and A now to see the animation, you can see just a sliver of that duplicate column is appearing right in that space right there. We're going to use that sliver we just made and have particles emit from that. Now let's go over to the particle buttons and click on New to create a new particle system. Let's increase the number of particles to 10,000. And let's see what we got so far. Let's press Alt and A, and some particles are shooting out from the origin, then they start shooting out from the top when it actually starts coming down. I don't think it's fully paying attention to the modifier stack yet, because we have to enable Use Modifier Stack. That'll make it so it actually performs the operations in the modifier stack, in our case, the Boolean operation, and then it uses that result to actually add the particle system. And we also have to change the start frame. So let me press numpad 1 for front view. Let me zoom into the top here. I want the start frame, which means when the particles begin spawning, I want that to be right when our sliver object cuts into the column the first time. So I'm going to press the right arrow on the keyboard. I'll just hold that in until it starts animating downward. And so our first frame, as you can see down here, the bottom left, is 77. So I'll change the start frame to 77. And while we're at it, we might as well plug in the end number. So I'm gonna hold Shift and press the up arrow, and it'll go down 10 frames at a time. And now I'll use the right arrow and see when the last cut on the column happens. So it happens at frame 433. So let me type in 433 as the end frame. And let me type in 0 and go back to the start. When you're working with particle simulations, in order to rerun that simulation properly, you have to go back to when the simulation begins in order for it to be recalculated right. And now let's press Alt and A and see what happens now. And there we go. Okay, now we're getting somewhere. Now, instead of actually going back to frame 0 all the time to rerun the simulation, we can actually bake the simulation with the cache panel over here. There's some options to do that. But we're not actually finished creating the particle simulation yet. And with such a simple simulation like this, I don't really think it's necessary to bake it anyway. So where are we at now? What was the problem we need to fix? Oh, right. The particles were falling pretty darn fast. So let's fix that by turning down the gravity influence on it. So I'm going to scroll down to the bottom panel here for field weights. And I'll turn gravity down to 0.005. You can put it at 0 if you want, but I would like to see these particles start floating downward after they're in the air a while. All right, now let's hover over the 3D view and press Alt and A from frame 0 and see what we got. All right, that's different. Just need to fix a few things now. Let's change the lifetime up to 200 so the particles don't die as fast. And they're also being emitted in different directions initially. So they have an initial velocity. So let's head over to the velocity panel here, and we'll change the normal velocity down to 0. So now they should just be added in and then start gently falling to the ground because of that tiny bit of gravity we left in. And after 200 frames, each particle spawned starts disappearing. All right, that's looking good. Now let's actually create the dust particle for the particle system. So let me press numpad 7 for top view. And let me zoom into the middle of the column there. Let's press Shift and A, and we'll add in a mesh cone. Let's press the T key immediately after that and go down to the operators panel down here. And let's change the number of vertices for the cone down to 3. And then press T to get rid of that. So here we have a bit of a pyramid. And let's press numpad 1 for front view. Press Tab to go into edit mode. And with all the vertices selected, I'll press S and then Z and scale that down so it's kind of proportional. So this is our dust particle. Now, it only has a couple of faces because we're going to be adding thousands and thousands of these, so we don't want it to slow things down too much. But I did want to have something that had faces, because as this rotates in the air, it's going to be catching the light differently and reflecting it back toward the camera, and that's going to create a cool sparkle effect as all this dust is flying off the top of the column. All right, now we just need to scale this down. So let me press numpad 7 for top view again, and I'll zoom in, and we'll scale that real small like that. And let's press numpad 1 for front view. Let's make sure that it's centered, or that we have the origin point in the center of the mass. All right. And let's press tab to get out of edit mode. And I'll press the end key for the right side toolbar. And let's rename this item to dust particle. Then press N to get rid of that. And then press the M key and we'll move that to the second layer because we don't need that right here. It's just going to spawn as particles in our particle system. All right, now let's select our particle system again, but right now it's invisible. So let's go select that from the outliner. And I assume it's one of these cylinders here. And I'll assume it's the invisible one. And here's all of our particle settings. So we got the right object. I should probably rename this, huh? So let me press the N key real quick. And I'll rename this to column-emitter. Then press N to get rid of that again. Now let's pan down to the render panel. And first of all, we'll disable emitter because we don't want this duplicate column to render. We just want the particles from it too. And let's change the particles by enabling object here. And now we can click on this field and select the object we want the particles to be, which is in this case, the dust particle. And let's see what we got by hovering over the 3D view and pressing Alt and A. You can see it's adding in our little pyramids as particles, but they're really tiny. So at least for the time being, I'm going to increase the size. And we can do that with the size option right here. Let me turn that up to 0.5. And let's see how that looks. So I'll press Alt and A again. And that looks good right now just to visualize things. And in fact, let me press the right arrow until I start seeing those particles so we can work with them. So you can see they're all being added in very uniformly. So let's first off start by randomizing the size. So let's increase the random size here to maybe 0.6, I think looks good. And now we got to work on randomizing the rotations as well. All right, so we're done down there. Let's scroll up to the rotation panel here. Click on that checkbox to enable it. And we'll give our particles some initial orientation by increasing the random value to 1. And what that's going to do is upon spawning, every one of these particles is going to be given a random rotation. You don't see any changes now because we need to rerun the simulation. So I'll just press the left arrow until it is a few frames before the particles start spawning. We don't actually have to go back to frame 0, just a couple frames before the particles actually start appearing. Now let's give those particles some rotation while they're actually floating in the air. So let's go over here and add some angular velocity this time. So first we'll need to enable dynamic and then increase angular velocity to 3. Now if we press Alt and A over here, you can see the rotating as they're falling down. All right, let's take a break from particles for a second and add in some wind. So I'll do that from top view by pressing numpad 7. I'll press Shift and A, and from the force field menu, I'll add in some wind. And let me press numpad 1 for front view. Now we want this blowing from right to left, so let's point this arrow here left. So I'll press R, hold control, and rotate it 90 degrees. Now let me press G, and I'll move that over there right into the middle of the height of the column. And let's press numpad 3 for side view. And let's press the comma key to switch back to bounding box pivot point scaling instead of the 3D cursor. And then press S and scale that up until it's a little bit bigger than the column. Actually, it's been a while since I used these, but I don't think the scale actually matters. But whatever. And it's blowing the particles, not exactly very fiercely. So let's increase the strength of this thing. So I'll press Escape and then go over to the physics buttons here. And we'll increase the strength up to, let's try 5. Let's press Alt and A and see how it looks. And that's much better, much better. Cool. So I'm going to keep it at 5. And now I'm looking at the particles and they're being blown across very uniformly. And it doesn't look all that interesting. I want them to kind of scatter a little bit as well. So let me go back into the outliner here and click on column emitter to select our particle system object again. And let's go back to the particle settings. And we'll increase the randomness by increasing the Brownian force right here. So I'll increase that to 6. And let's press Alt and A and see how it looks. And that is much better. Let me press numpad 0 for camera view. And I'll press the Z key for shaded view. Cool. Let me see that again from the start. Perfect. Awesome. All right, now let's move some things out of this layer that we don't actually need. So I'm going to select both of our box objects up there. I'll press the M key and I'll move that to the second layer. Now the last thing we'll do is animate the wind generator just for some variation in how the dust is blowing off the column. So let's go down to the timeline and activate this button here for automatic keyframing. That makes it so whenever we change the frame and then move or rotate or scale an object, it will automatically insert a keyframe for that. So we're going to do kind of an interesting way of animating right now. I'm going to press Alt and A to start the animation. And then once it starts over, I'm going to start rotating this. I'll just press the R key and start rotating it. So now I'll press R. And let's wait for it to start again. And I'll do this. And I'll just get it blowing the way I want it to. And then once the dust is off the screen, I'll right click. And as you can see, when the animation starts over, all those keyframes were added in. So that thing's rotating on its own now because that animation was recorded. All right, so that's actually all there is to it. Now you can add more particles if you want. I used a lower number just so the simulations ran faster for the tutorial, but you can definitely add a lot more particles for a denser cloud of dust. And that's gonna do it for this video. And that's a good thing too, because my neighbors just started cursing each other off and I don't want that picked up on the mic. So I'll see you around. If you like this tutorial and you're interested in more comprehensive Blender training, then check out my course, Complete Vehicle Production in Blender. This is a step-by-step guide on the entire creation process of a Jeep Wrangler, including modeling inside and out, creating all the shaders from scratch, and rendering out the final product. Check out the link in the description for more details, and stay tuned for new videos every weekend.